Hello, this is Vaughn Henshaw. Welcome to our show today. Today I want to make a plea with the United States senators, the congressmen, the representatives throughout the United States of America. I want to talk just a few minutes about the current death with dignity laws that are legalized in about 10 or 11 states, Oregon, Vermont, a few other states, where it's legalized to die with dignity. And what that means at the very outset, let me explain to you what that means. Death with dignity allows a person in America with a 6-month diagnosis to live. In other words, the doctor only gives you 6 months or less to live. Then in those states where this is allowed, you can go and go through this process, a very detailed process to take what I call the cocktail of death. And I think you can get it done intravenously with an IV. I've heard you can take a pill, and I've heard you can drink a liquid concoction. And the current death with dignity laws in America are a good start in the right direction, but they don't go as far as they need to go, and I'm going to tell you why. October 1984, I was 14 years old, and I was a quarterback on a football team. And in the middle of that game, my left leg began falling out from underneath me, and I couldn't stand up. I'd stand up for a few minutes, and I'd fall back down. 2 or 3 weeks later, my parents took me to the doctor, and I was diagnosed with facioscapulohumeral muscular dystrophy, commonly known as FSH muscular dystrophy. That was over 37 years ago. I'm now 51 years old. Over those years, I went from wearing a full-length left leg brace from my hip down to my ankle into a wheelchair part-time. And then in March of 2010, I was no longer able to stand up, bear weight, or walk. And in 2009, about a year prior to that, I was diagnosed with COPD, not because I smoked, but because of the weakened muscles around my lungs. And what muscular dystrophy does, it deteriorates and eats away at your muscles. And I'll show you a picture of my arm here, if I can get this up. That's my arm. So my legs are very small like that. I can fit my entire hand around my arm right there with that much left over. So anyway, I've had this 37 years. And I deal with chronic pain every day of my life. Shoulders, I went to the doctor in June of this year because of my shoulder pain. And they said that if I live long enough, due to the deterioration of the shoulder muscles and all that's involved in that part of your body, then I will lose total loss of function in both of my arms, which the doctor, the bone surgeon that took those x-rays, looked at me and she said, "You will have no quality of life, and let's just hope you die before it gets to that point." So therefore, that made me an even stronger advocate, proponent, and an ambassador for the death with dignity movement. And so, like I said earlier, the laws in America are only for those with a 6-month terminal illness diagnosis, which, let's be honest, that's generally cancer. The rest of us that suffer endlessly, needlessly, daily, we have no alternative. We have no option but to endure this suffering. I've had doctors that have suggested that I go on pain medication. I don't want to do that. I've not done that. And I don't want to do that for several reasons. Number one, most of them are addictive. Number two, most of them end up hurting your body. And so I deal with this every day. And my shoulders hurt. I'm in this wheelchair generally 15, 16 hours a day. And then I have stomach issues likely related to the MD. We're not sure what all that's involved with yet. I'm down to eating. All I can tolerate eating right now is boiled chicken with no skin, boiled pork, boiled potatoes and toast. And that's it, and water, I drink water. So, what we need to do here in America is to rewrite these death with dignity laws, and we need to get these passed in every state. There's no reason why we cannot get what Canada has got. The medical assistance in dying in Canada, is it perfect? For example, if I was a resident of Canada right now, I would be eligible to go get on the list of individuals who want the medical aid in dying. I have a chronic, incurable disease. There's no cure. There's no therapy. There's no pill. There's nothing that can reverse this. It just gets worse over time. So I would be eligible for Canada's medical aid in dying. Here in America, I'm not eligible because I don't have a 6-month terminal diagnosis. So what does Canada's law look like? Let me read it to you. In order to be eligible for medical assistance in dying in Canada, the individual must meet one of the or more of these following criteria. I'm sorry, you must meet all of these criteria. You must be eligible for health services funded by the federal government of Canada or a province or a territory. Or you must meet the minimum period of residence or waiting period for eligibility. So I can't go to Canada tonight and sign up on their medical aid in dying because I'm not a resident of Canada. Number two, you must be at least 18 years old and mentally competent. Three, here's the one I like. You must have a grievous and irremediable, incurable, irreversible medical condition, such as muscular dystrophy. And then you have to make a voluntary request for Canada's medical aid in dying. And you have to give informed consent to receive it. Now, what do they consider grievous and an irremediable condition? You must meet all of the following criteria. Number one, you must have a serious illness, disease, or disability. Mental illness is not covered in this law. Number two, you must be in an advanced state of decline that cannot be reversed. And three, you must be experiencing unbearable physical or mental suffering from your illness, disease, disability, or state of decline that cannot be relieved under conditions that you consider acceptable. And this last sentence sums it up. It says, you do not need to have a fatal or a terminal condition to be eligible for medical assistance in dying. The United States of America must adopt this law in all 50 states. Let me be a voice of reason. Let me be a voice for those that do not have a voice, those that are suffering like I am, a lot worse than I am, suffering at home, suffering in nursing homes, whatever the case may be. Let me be the voice for them. There is no reason why, as long as we are in our sound mind and we're cognitively aware of what's going on, there's absolutely no reason why we cannot choose to end our life with dignity through medical assistance. Now let me bring this up. I'm not referring to suicide. Myself, I'm not suicidal. If I were, there's a half hundred ways to do that. I would have already done it. What I'm talking about is bringing an end to our day in, day out, needlessly suffering. I remember when I was a boy, a neighbor's dog got out of their fenced-in yard, got hit by a car. It didn't kill the dog. They took it to the vet. The veterinarian said this. Said, you know, your dog will live, but he's going to be in pain for the rest of his life. And with the type of injury it was, there was nothing really could be done for the dog to improve it. So the veterinarian said, the humane thing to do is to put the dog out of its misery. My question to you, America, to you senators, to you congressmen, to you state representatives, all politicians, all medical doctors for that matter, why don't we do the same thing for human beings? Why must I continue to suffer and thousands of other men and women, boys and girls around this nation? Why must we continue to suffer when it is so simple to pass a law that would give us a dignified way of ending our lives? I'll leave you with that question. And I hope and pray that America adopts the exact medical aid and assistance with dying laws that Canada has adopted. And let's help stop people like me, countless others who are suffering every day of our lives.